The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Good night and welcome to The Doctor Is In with me, Dr. Janothra Archer-Cartwright, family medicine specialist, CEO and medical director of Medical Concierge Services. Tonight, of course, brought to you by Medical Concierge Services for all your medical health needs. We're located at 72 Collins Avenue in the Bahamas Heart Center. If you're trying to reach us, the numbers are 326-1521. WhatsApp 429-4880, and you can catch us on Facebook and Instagram. And on Instagram, we are medical_concierge_services. Thank you for joining me for another exciting evening of all things health, wellness, and things that pertain to the Bahamian society. Tonight, we're talking about the pandemic. And is it over or is it near over? Are things changing in the dynamics of COVID and our healthcare in the country? And this is something because we've never kind of pinpointed where or what would be our end to all of this. And so we're just gonna take a look at what's going on around the world. And also we're going to kind of think about what it is for a pandemic to be over and what's next. And should we be moving along the lines of being prepared for that? Or have we just been pretty much stagnant with this whole thing? We're very linked to the World Health Organizations and the things that they do and a lot of international organizations. So I think we're really waiting for them to tell us that the pandemic is over. But as we can see in our own country, our numbers have been very low, thank God. And our death rate has gone down considerably. So I think that is something as a positive light at the end of the tunnel, hopefully, for us here in the Bahamas. We're also seeing numbers go down in other places. There are some places that are having a little peak here and there, but it's just not where we were a year or even 2 years ago. In fact, when I looked online, they said the numbers in the Bahamas are only at 1% of what they were at our peak. We're averaging somewhere between 3 to 5 cases per week. And this is considered considerably low. We've also been having, changes in the grade for our traveling restrictions from other countries because of our very low numbers. Bahamas is becoming one of the safest places probably in the world to be. And we hope that it stays that way. And I think what we saw was a great change with the last wave that we had, which is, very high peaked, but then we saw less deaths. So that Omicron, which really went through a lot of people, vaccinated, unvaccinated, really changed everything. So what does that mean? Well, I saw a really interesting article in CNN Travel that kind of looked at what was going around, going on in different countries as they removed their restrictions. And so I'm just going to go through that article, and then we're going to talk about what it means to be in a pandemic versus endemic. And any of you who have been following me, I've been talking about the fact that COVID-19 is likely going to become something that's endemic, which means that it'll either be seasonal or it'll be something that remains at relatively low numbers where we can expect it to be around. And how do we switch from the mindset of being in a pandemic to an endemic? And if you can see, the recent festivities in the country, I don't know how anyone can make a claim after what we saw on display the last week or so with our international guests that we should have some of the restrictions that we do. But I'm sure there may be an argument for some of that. But let's look at what CNN had to say, you know, and this is liberal media, so this is kind of like nothing to say conservative or anything like that. But the article in CNN Travel goes, COVID? A small but increasing number of destinations are lifting all of their COVID-related travel restrictions regarding the vaccination status, including some of our European favorites. Included in this is the United Kingdom, Ireland, and Hungary. All swell the ranks this month. The Caribbean island of Aruba, the Portuguese archipelago of Madeira, the North Central Asian Mongolia, have all lifted their main COVID entry requirements. They join Iceland, Norway, and Slovenia, which have all shed their country's rules in February. Other countries are watching closely to measure the success or failure of these bold moves as Omicron continues to spread around the world. The U.S. Center of Disease Control and Prevention Travel Advisory list increasingly a hoarse voice, Cassandra, still has about 125 destinations in the highest risk avoid travel category and within the latest edition of its article. So they're the ones who do the ranking. They're kind of controlling all of this. I am pretty sure that our ranking changed by two within recent times. So I think even if we kept some of our travel restrictions definitely within the country, I think that, okay, I didn't really open the lines, but we have a caller. Caller, you're on the air.
Hello, good day. Good evening, Mr. Dr. Archer Cartwright.
Hi.
Do you know you are the Bahamas doctor, and we appreciate you.
Thank you.
If the caller's, I mean, one or two states, like, you know, 52, they say, well, they appreciate you. But we do appreciate you, all the doctors, because you was able to stand next to Jesus Christ when the COVID-19 first hit the Bahamas in 2020, January, and you was there, and you never left us. So we really do appreciate that. Concerning what you're talking about now, as it relates to us, the restrictions, I'm an FNM, but I voted TRP. But you got to be real, Mr. Davis, he did lift up a lot of the restrictions. And if we look in Britain, I don't know if you agree. You agree?
If you look Britain,
even the airlines, they lift restrictions. The planes say you don't need to wear no mask. You know what I mean? I think they come to the understanding of normalcy. And as for us, you know, in the Bahamas, normalcy is Caribbean. Normalcy is a Christian nation. Normalcy is like we love our tourists and, you know, we do what we do. What you think?
Yeah, I mean, I think we love our tourists, but we also love ourselves. I've always been about protecting Bahamians, and then everybody else will be protected, right, as long as we do that. I'll give you a scenario. I was at Atlantis on the weekend, and everyone who was a guest and everyone who was there was allowed not to wear a mask, but the staff was forced to wear a mask. And most of them are still testing or, you know, every week. And so I just found that to be kind of odd that you would lift the requirements there, but not for the staff that is also doing testing as well. Yeah. So I would just like to see a little bit of balance and kind of an understanding of why it's kind of still very discriminatory.
That's a clear response. Because you had the doctor from the state. I don't know what he's I forget his name, who you had on the air, who talked.
Yeah, and he's going to be here next week.
About the children too, like the children don't take the children through that. And you did things. And we do, where he was from, what, Arizona?
He's from Texas. He's from Texas. And he's actually going to be here in the Bahamas with me next week. Dr. Peter McCullough?
Yeah, McCullough. He's a serious doctor too.
Like, yeah, he is.
Fox News has totally said it would really support him. Like that, CNN, they don't, they in and them. But
well, you know, it's sad that the pandemic became really politicized, especially in America, I would say, where it almost became like if you are Republican, you're kind of on one side, and if you're a Democrat. And, you know, medicine and healthcare is something that should never be politics, sadly, but you know, politics gets into everything.
That too.
Right. So doctors who had a slightly different point of view in order to get their information and data out had to kind of go where they needed to go to get that information out there. I think things are becoming a little bit more open now, but it was really challenging to be, for everything to be out in the air. It just, COVID was a very weird time for everybody.
The Texas, and he was in alliance, I mean, in one accord with the Florida governor, you know, because you said when you've been to Florida, like everything normal, and I'm glad that you brought normalcy back to the Bahamas. I think Brave Davis, they listen to you. I hope they don't try to give you a contract so you can leave Guardian, you know, take people all of yours.
I would help the government whatever they want to do as long as they're doing it where it's going to be beneficial to the Bahamian public. Like, but, you know, I don't really change. But, you know, I have no issues with any government that wants to do things that are positive. I think with this government, I don't want to get political. It was good to see that they did lift some of the restrictions, and they were kind of not interested in doing the lockdowns anymore, which was pretty good. We needed to get out of that. And, you know, the data on lockdown shows that it didn't make a difference. So 0.02% effective. That's terrible. So I think them taking that approach was very calming for a lot of Bahamians who were just tired of all of that. And I understand that they want to take a gradual and
slow not disregarding approach. The efforts of the previous government. I mean, they tried. You know what I mean? They did their best. But at least they brought us through. At least we out now.
Just
say one thing.
Yeah. I think it was a difficult place to be. I think it was a difficult place to be. I don't agree with all of the stuff that they did and how they did it. But I have to admit that it was a difficult...
That was a trial. That was a world trial. And I'm glad the Lord brought us out. And guess what? The first thing in January 2020, when it first hit us, before March, before we go on really into it, Dr. Dwayne Sands, you know, he did this, he tried, and you know, he got fired because he fall off. He did fall off. You know what I mean?
Hopkins.
He gone with John Hopkins. You.
No, I really like
Dr.
Sands. I really like Dr. Sands. I think number one, it's the people who are advising you.
Fall off.
And I remember what got him in problems now, right?
Yeah.
His preference to the foreigners coming in. Even though they were providing something that we needed.
The minister had a duty, I thank God for minister too. Minister had a duty he had to do because minister noticed Dwayne Sands fall off. But Dwayne Sands was the one who said, remember he told us before the virus was, when it was in China, And like in 2019, around like in November, to inside say, don't worry about that. It's just an influenza. So y'all don't worry about that. It's just a SARS, the same thing. And then when I hit the Bahamas, he switched.
Well, I think, like I was starting off the show, they got a lot of guidance from PAHO and WHO, not to say anything bad about PAHO or WHO, but, you know, it was just like these broad directives. What should have happened with Dr. Sands and the public health team was that they should have taken into context how this would affect the Bahamas. So for the first time, we saw the world take a very broad approach, and we realized that, you know, by doing that, and just thinking specifically about COVID and only COVID and not looking at the broader picture in terms of how that would affect the economy and all these other things, they actually probably created more problems than solved them.
I like how you trying to sign Dr. Dwayne Science bill, but this is what I say.
Yeah.
He loved John Hopkins, his school where he went to.
Yeah.
He loved it more than he did love, like, the true situation concerning the release of the virus from China and from the Wuhan. You know what I mean? Like, he loved John Hopkins. He gone with the WTO. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
WHO. He gone with that.
Yeah. WHO. Yeah. Well, like, he's American and trained. So, you know, like I'm UE trained. So I think I take a more cultural approach to certain things, because I realize that sometimes we follow what we call these first world countries, sometimes even into a ditch. And if you worship that type of thing, not saying that he does, but if that is your pinnacle of success or what you think is the gold standard, then, you know, you can fall into that trap. I really don't look at things like that. I always have this opinion that, you know, whatever education that I got is just on par with anywhere else.
I think
Bahamians,
you can fall into
Caribbean people, we can think for ourselves.
Yeah, I like how you said that, though. You could fall into that trap.
Mm.
It's easily.
And I think a lot of countries did. You know, we are set to trust these institutions, global institutions, because, you know, they've been there for us in the past. But, you know, blind loyalty, I think, got us into trouble with the COVID thing. And we're seeing that as we backtrack worldwide. There were those of us who saw it from the beginning, and there are those of us that it required time to kind of analyze. Because we've come to the point in the world where we've become very trusting, because it's been a very safe world generally for most of us. And we've never had a need not to trust.
Yeah.
And so
I was on Paradise Island, right? And I was thinking, I say, Dr. Archer, and when I hear Dr. Fauci, like, you know, he say, he considered retiring, you know what I mean? I say, where Dr. Archer Cartwright, she made Dr. Fauci retire.
Oh, it wasn't me.
You know, like,
but a lot of people were campaigning that
wear two masks, wear one mask, wear two masks, wear no mask. Yes, gee, what does Ma want us to do?
The
CDC laws. Everyone,
I think they were all a little lost.
Yeah, but
they were all a little lost.
Lord, brother,
I think, you know, when you're trying to create a narrative, you know, and you're fighting the actual science, and you want people to go a certain way, that's what gets you into trouble. If they had stuck with the truth and just laying things on the line and not trying to create your perception for you, they wouldn't have gotten themselves in trouble. And that's, even they have admitted that they didn't say a lot of things, they didn't give away a lot of information because they didn't want you to look at things a certain way. But we are all adults that can make up our own minds. And so you provide us the information, and then we make the best decision for ourselves. We don't require people
to
do that for us.
We have to be real. We have to be real. The truth is, it was a biological chemical weapon released from the lab. It went into the market, and they put it in the birds, and it was a chemical weapon. And guess what? I like what China did, but when they blow the whole hotel with 100 rooms with the people, China, like, they try to wipe it out. They try to stop it. They try. I ain't gonna lie. China, yeah. They try. And they stop it, but it still got out. You know what I mean? Because it was, like, plutonium. Like, it was real. And it was,
It's definitely real. So, you know, COVID was definitely real. It was definitely something new for all of us. It was definitely an experience that I don't want to go through again. You know, this whole thing was quite intense. And I take pleasure that, I think it's winding down. I think the strains are becoming weaker. And I think that we can find some semblance of normalcy coming back, and not a new normal, but, good normal. And I think if we take that more positive approach, because I keep hearing about these fourth and fifth waves, but I think if we keep a positive approach and we really look at the science and we look at the trajectory of what's happening, I think that we would see that we're actually going to a good place.
But just before I go, I want to say that I think now, based on the weather, the sun, and the breeze, I think, and the food we eat, I think it's the electronic that. The electro, it's coming out of our blood, and I think it's not too much in the air no more, and I think we're coming back to normalcy. But I really want to say before I leave that my priest, the Orthodox Greek priest, you know, he tell me, say, "Tiger, have no fear, don't worry about this, everything will be okay." And see, Dr. Osama, a real doctor. He say, "Don't worry about nothing. Everything will be okay." I was so scared.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry you were afraid, but I think you're right. And in science kind of way, I think a lot of people, if we were to do a study, and this is why I want us to elevate the way we do medicine and science here. If I think we would put some money into doing some research, we would find that most Bahamians have probably encountered COVID. And I think that's why you're seeing a change, because all kind of flu-like illnesses have these sharp peaks when they first come about. And as it become what we call endemic in the country and numbers go down, is because people, healthy people have encountered it. And basically the strains are now weakened, and it'll become like a flu, more closer to the flu. And we've already started seeing that. So let's thank God for that. Thank you, caller, for calling in. You know, I appreciate that. And since the lines are open, I might as well give the number 322-6232-325-4316, 325-4259. We're talking about the pandemic. You know, is it ending? Is it winding down? Is it over? And are we moving on track for what we're seeing in terms of our numbers? As we were talking about before, you know, our numbers are pretty low. Thankfully, our death rate is going down and we're starting to cope a lot better. So we're hoping that the restrictions start to fall away and we can lose some of the discriminatory aspects of some of our laws that are in place. We're looking at the what's going on in the rest of the world and kind of just unlocking what's happening through one of these articles in CNN. The article then goes on to talk about the changes, as the caller was talking about, in the mask mandates that are happening on a lot of the planes. And they are just kind of going towards making it quite optional for persons to have to wear a mask. And, you know, that's coming about. So mask wearing has been a contentious issue on planes over the past 2 years. The U.S. Transportation Security Administration issued more than $6,444,000 in fines for alleged mask violations since February 2021. The U.S. mask mandate is currently set to be in place through April 18, where it's lifted or extended again. There are bound to be some unhappy passengers either way. And if some industry advocates get their way, a no-fly list for unruly travelers could help keep that behavior in check. So people are looking at these types of things. I think it's gonna come where, you know, the thing about it is if you remove these restrictions, people have choices. people have choices of what they would like to do. So if you are, you know, you're still kind of wary, you want to wear a mask, I don't think anything's wrong with that. We all have different levels of risk that we're willing to tolerate, and some people are willing not to wear a mask. Because really, you know, we wear masks, we take it off to eat and all this stuff like that. To me, it's neither here nor there. So those things are happening. They talk about openings in Turkey and different places, so that they're doing connected flights to Europe and Asia now, and what's going on in those parts of the country. So Nordic nations of Finland has just named the world's happiest country for the fifth year in a row. And I think they are also kind of opening those things up. So the world is opening up. We are here in the Bahamas. I'm starting to promote the Bahamas as tourism. You could take this one, or you could pay me royalties for this, but the safest nation in the world. I think we're doing really, 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 really well. And so we need to start considering those things. So I'm just going to tackle the difference between a pandemic and epidemic, endemic and an outbreak. And then we can kind of decide, where are we? Where are we going with this? And how do people feel about, you know, wearing a mask, not wearing a mask, and just kind of getting rid of some of these restrictions? I'll tell you a couple of things, like I told you, that bothered me. Bahamian workers wearing a mask and tourists aren't wearing a mask. I think that's kind of odd, but that I was told was an Atlantis policy. So the company would have to be comfortable with its workers not wearing a mask. It's kind of strange because they actually lobbied for their guests not to wear a mask. So I think that's kind of weird. Vax versus not vax, I don't think that really matters anymore. We know people catch COVID regardless, and people need to be allowed to stratify their risks. We still have schedules according to the Medical Health and Safety Act, in which New Providence and I believe Grand Bahama, you still have to do a PCR test, especially if you're not vaccinated. You have to be tested from going to island to island. I really don't understand that whatsoever. I think the last report I saw, we had one case yesterday, I think in New Providence. So that's highly a large difference, one case and zero cases. And that one case was the entire country. So we are really still having really strong restrictions for a country with few cases. And so I think now those things need to match. If you still want to have considerations for people coming into the country, but I think within the country, especially Bahamians, we need to look at some of those things to be changed. So let's take a look. So what's the difference between pandemic, which is what we are in? We are calling this a pandemic. An epidemic, an endemic, is what I'm talking about. It's just kind of where I think that we're going, and what we call an outbreak. And this is coming from the Intermountain Healthcare blog, and it talks about not all infectious disease terms are created equal, though often they are mistakenly used interchangeably. So we kind of, if you don't really know those words, they all kind of sound the same, but you've probably been hearing them throughout. So we're just going to talk simple definitions of what those things mean. So an endemic is a disease that affects a large number of people within a community, a population, or region. So if you have a disease, it's affecting a lot of people in a particular community, within a population, or a region. So let's say you had something going on in a specific island, or within the Bahamian population, or within the region, such as the Caribbean region, or, you know, the West Indies, or the, you know, a particular place. And then we would just call it an epidemic because it's kind of restricted to those places. Then a pandemic, which we consider COVID-19 was a pandemic because it spread over multiple countries and continents, right? And then endemic, which is something that belongs to a particular people or group. An outbreak is a greater than anticipated increase in the number of endemic cases. So endemic is kind of also, when you think about endemic, it's not just a particular people or a country, It's usually something that's just kind of expected. It's just there lying low, kind of like the flu. We kind of know it's going to happen. We kind of know it's cyclic. It has seasons. And then an outbreak is when you have higher numbers than anticipated. So the question is, are we able to anticipate what our COVID numbers would be? And it does take a bit of time to do that because we have been going through cycles. But as you can see, up until the last, what I would say is, it's not even just numbers. We also have to look at the death rate. And thankfully, our death rate has gone down considerably, as far as I can see from the numbers. So that is probably going to be our better indicator because that was the issue with COVID. Nobody wants to die from COVID. And so epidemic versus a pandemic. So a simple way to know the difference between an epidemic and a pandemic is remember that the P in pandemic, which means the pandemic has a passport. In other words, it's going around, it's traveling around. So in a sense, COVID is still kind of a pandemic because it's traveling around. But where it changes is how we perceive that. So if we only expect it to be in one particular place and it's moving to another particular place, that's kind of the pandemic feeling for it. Whereas when we start to just determine that it's everywhere, it's not really moving around anymore because, you know, it's everywhere. And so it's actually kind of our perspective on whether it is a pandemic or not. And then when we look at the epidemic versus the endemic, the difference between those two, the epidemic is actively spreading new cases of disease, substantially exceeding what is expected. More broadly, it is used to describe any problem that's out of control, such as an opioid epidemic. An epidemic is also localized to a region, but the number of those infected in that region is significantly higher than normal. For example, when COVID-19 was limited to Wuhan, China, it was epidemic. Their geographical spread turned it into a pandemic. The endemics, on the other hand, are a constant presence in a specific location. Malaria is endemic to parts of Africa. Ice is endemic to Antarctica. So essentially, it is where it is found. And perhaps COVID is going to be one of those things that's going to be endemic across the world. And I think that is what's going to shift our understanding of it being a pandemic. Because if we keep on considering it like a surprise, is it a surprise anymore? It's not really a surprise. We kind of know it's there. We kind of know that cases kind of go up and down cyclically. So can we not kind of expect that at this point? It's 2 years in. It's not brand new. Can we expect to know what that looks like? And can we start doing modeling of what our expectations would be? Because we saw that modeling earlier in the pandemic where they kind of said, hey, we're going to have this, we're going to have that, and maybe be prepared for that. So I think if anything that we learned out of this pandemic is that we need to anticipate, we need to plan for these types of things the best that we can. We never know what's going to happen, but the best that we can. 2 years in, I would like to see a lot of that evidence, a lot of the statistics that we collected in the Bahamas now going into our own models of what we think are going to happen instead of such a heavy reliance on what's going on in other countries. Although watching what's happening in other countries is extremely important and a part of that, we do have to have some kind of way of kind of interpreting for ourselves how to deal with things, how to be prepared for it, and how does that work in the construct of our own country, our resources, and the things that we need. And I think that is kind of the important point of all of this. And also just be prepared for that winding down process and what that would look like, and still keep ourselves vigilant of what's happening around the world. So the last point on this particular section is I just wanted to look at endemic versus outbreak. Going one step further, an endemic can lead to an outbreak, and an outbreak can happen anywhere. Last summer, dengue fever outbreak in Hawaii is an example of dengue fever is endemic to a certain region in Africa, Central and South America and the Caribbean. Mosquitoes in these areas carry dengue fever and transmit it from the Caribbean. Mosquitoes in this area These areas carry dengue fever and transmit it from person to person. But in 2019, there was an outbreak of dengue fever in Hawaii, where the disease is not endemic, so not found. It is believed that an infected person visited the Big Island and was bitten by mosquitoes there. The insects then transferred the disease to other individuals they bite, which created an outbreak. So an outbreak is more, you know, we keep on talking about these waves, or, you know, as if, you know, they're kind of unexpected. But what I'm saying is now we need to transition into not thinking about it in the sense of an outbreak or a pandemic, but more of an endemic kind of response. And so that would change the way and the gravity of our reactions. I think that's going to be healthy for us if we can do that, because that will stabilize the country and allow us to get back to some sort of normal. Because I think a lot of people are already kind of there. It's just about our policies and everything to catch up with that. And so that's extremely important. So it's hard to confuse those terms, but I thought it was important to kind of look at them, because this is how we are categorizing what's happening in the country. And so the point is to move away from this idea of being a pandemic to a more endemic situation where this is not an emergency, but something where we have a sustainable plan to go by, you know. So and that will be a healthier way for us to look forward. I'd like to see some of those things coming out, that we can see that happening and happening a little bit more vibrantly and being more engaged with the people who are involved. So we'll take a quick break and we'll talk a little bit more about this. And of course, we're gonna open the lines back up and we'll talk about Dr. Peter McCullough and him being in town. So see you after the break on The Doctor's Inn with me, Dr. D. Archer.
Junior just showed me Bulla Boy in his phone.
What you mean? He take picture of that good for nothing boy?
Shh, you don't want Bulla hair. You say that. You know she always say that's my good child.
So what he doing in Junior phone?
Oh, he there because the police looking for him. He on that wanted list.
Wanted persons in your phone now?
Yes, child. And when police want to find anybody quick, after something happened, they can send picture direct to your phone. Go to Google Play or App Store and search for Crack Crime Bahamas, then pick install and it will go straight to your phone.
There is also a section on missing persons.
Yes, girl. Everybody needs to get this app so police can tell us right away when these people go missing. Just like an alert system.
Yes, it has numbers for Crime Stoppers Bahamas, so you can call and nobody knows you. Call directly to Miami and give the information without giving your name or anything about you. I tried the other day, and when I hear Junior and his boys talking about where they hide those guns, I walk quick round the corner and call that number.
Call 328-8477 from Nassau or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands.
When I got prostate cancer, my family didn't know if I was going to live at Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Within days, I got an appointment. They presented me with treatment options, and they set up a robotic prostatectomy. When my scans came back, there are no signs of cancer. They don't see you as a number. They see you as a part of family. I'm going on with my life. It's a real gift.
Call us at Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
Hello and welcome back to The Doctor's Inn with me, Dr. Dinothra Archer Cartwright, Family Medicine Specialist, brought to you tonight, of course, by Medical Concierge Services. You can check us online. And for those of you who are looking for our sign up for NHI, you can find it on our website, mcsfamilymedicine.com. We were talking tonight about if the pandemic is over, what's going on. How are things going to change? Are we ready to go back to normal? We did have a caller earlier, and we're going to open the lines in case anyone else wants to jump in and give their opinion on this. How do you feel about all of this? 323-6232-325-4316, 325-4259. And just a reminder, Dr. Peter McCullough. He's going to be in town in Nassau, Bahamas. He's paying me a visit. He's going to be live. We're going to do some other shows as well. And we're going to also, with a group called Optimus, we're going to have a town hall meeting. So if you guys want to get involved or even come out and listen to his presentation, he will be here live. And so I'll have more information about that next week. But that will be next week, Thursday, that we're having that presentation, and it's going to be on various platforms. So you guys can all get a chance to listen, see it live, or come down and see us at the presentation itself. So we were talking about this pandemic, and oh, tell me to say the numbers one more time. 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. So we were talking about the pandemic. Is it done? What does this mean for us? I saw another interesting article in Science, and they're talking about when is the pandemic over? World Health Organization prepares to confront thorny decisions. And so this is one of the organizations we talked about earlier, who really kind of putting out there what should be happening. And I know the Bahamas really is invested in the WHO and through PAHO and different organizations that really kind of give us a lot of direction. So in the article, it talks about when SARS-CoV-2 outbreak initially kind of hit and became a public health emergency, and how this committee of experts basically got together at the World Health Organization to assess whether it was a pandemic. And every 3 months, most recently in January, the advisors have unanimously agreed that it does. The World Health Organization director, Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus, had accepted the verdict when the committee meets again next month. So January, March, April. So they're meeting again. And so we're going to have a global response to whether this is considered a pandemic or not. And perhaps that's what our government is waiting for. I don't know, but that could perhaps be it, because the article does speak to the connection that the World Health Organization has with different countries and why we really haven't seen it kind of, you know, moving on from there. And basically that whatever comes out of it, that the director will kind of accept whatever the panel says. But at some point, it estimates range from months to years from now, the WHO has to make a difficult call. Already, nations such as Denmark, Netherlands, and the United Kingdom have functionally declared to end the pandemic in their countries, lifting most of their health restrictions, even as New Zealand and Hong Kong struggle with record-breaking surges. So we can see that some countries have taken on the responsibility themselves to say, hey, you know what? This is not really affecting us like this. We understand what's going on in the rest of the world. But this is really not a pandemic in a sense for us. And deciding when to sound the all clear, not an inevitable task, said Yonata Grad, an infectious disease epidemiologist at Harvard School of Public Health. Do you call it over when there might still be a wave in one part of the world, but it's a small part? And so these are the things that I guess we're trying to consider. You know, even if this thing's happening somewhere else and the other countries being affected, how much does that play into a country's position on all of this? And some countries have decided, hey, we're going to just say it's over for us. And these are the type of hard decisions we have to make as leaders. This is the type of hard decisions that we have to consciously decide what's right for our individual countries. And so to many, the article goes on to talk about, to many outside of China, where COVID-19 struck first, the statement that Tedros 2 years ago this week describing SARS-CoV-2 as a global pandemic marked its official start. But his 11th of March 2020 comments triggered no public health requirements. Rather, the declaration with particular implication was at the 30th of January of 2020. So even though the WHO kind of made that statement, they really were not the ones to implicate and start all the policy changes. So that was PHEIC. that really kind of did that. And that is the public health emergency of international concern, really where that was made. And that is legally binds 196 signatories to follow the WHO's recommendations during emergency. So what the article is saying is that because all of these countries basically have signed on, they're kind of compelled to follow the WHO, or they're compelled to follow what this public health emergency of international concern really binds them to. That caller, you're on the air.
Yes, good night, Dr. Z.
Hi, how you doing?
Yeah, I'm all right. The doctor of truth. Of course, I'm excited to listen to Dr. Peter McCullough, right? I hope you let him know he have a fan over here in Nassau, Bahamas, right?
Okay.
I call him the doctor of truth also. But the thing is,
yes,
I wanted you to realize that when France withdrew, they didn't really withdraw from NATO, but they had a special rearrangements with NATO, right? So they wouldn't be into, as far as the military aspect, like, where they know, well, France had a problem with America controlling NATO, America and Britain being the big sayers in NATO. And so they had a special arrangement, but they still in NATO, I think, right? So the same thing with signing under the WHO, man, this is scientific dictatorship at its peak. So the question is, you ask, the pandemic, it's not going to end. It's going to be a viral merry-go-round. You know, I know what it is because I've already done enough rereading on it for years now. I've been following it. So when you have Mr. B. Gates saying, sadly, the Omicron is producing B and T-cell immunity, right? That shows you, and then he's saying there'll be another pandemic. Of course, these people run the world. They already have it all scammed out. It doesn't matter who agree or disagree. But what I'm saying is, when you look at the whole chronology of the outbreak and all of the steps taken by the global sheep, it is disappointing because that's why I like listening to Warren. Warren said, we shut down the country when we had one case of COVID.
Mm-hmm.
All right?
One
so
case.
We saw the puppet masters at work. We are seeing the puppet masters at work. You know, people have sent me information that I've met you, Guardian, so it's paid off for me. So in South Korea, they're 80% vax, but yet still they're seeing a surge, and now the CDC passed some mandate saying to avoid travel to South Korea. So I look at it as a viral merry-go-round. China, where it started, they haven't locked down again. So it's a reset, and it's reverberating. Most people can't conceive what's going on right now. The gentleman who called you, that's one of your fans too. I like when he called, but he's making me think too. But the thing is, he doesn't realize the transmission mechanisms of viruses. It didn't have to be intentionally leaked, you know. As well as,
yeah.
I think it was. But remember the three lab workers that work on the gain of function research that were sick.
That was sick prior.
And they didn't report it. So Dr. Alana.
But you know, it's clearly, it's SARS-CoV-19. People forget that. We think about what happened in 2020, but it's obvious that it was already being, you know, thought about from the year before.
Yeah, but Dr. D, the thing is, if everyone didn't know what virologists know, I'm not a virologist, but I know what I know, and I have confidence in what I know. You cannot gaslight me. My knowledge is the only thing a poor man has. What I'm saying is, when you understand the influenza virus within itself, they should have never picked this virus to do a gain-of-function research. You saw the letter from the NIH chief saying that the Wuhan Institute of Virology was contracted to make the virus 10,000 times more virulent, but they breached the contract and whatever, et cetera. That letter is dubious to me because that's after the fact. Now, you have Christine Nordland, the CDC chief spokesman. She called for... I think it's a CDC chief. She called for the public to be more educated on the scientific literature, which I totally agree with. But then remember now, the CDC is withholding data on the vaccine information
basically,
and adverse events, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
And then she said that this is not ready for prime time. So I think they went to court, and now they have to release the papers incrementally, right? You saw
they've
that, right?
They've started releasing the documents.
Yeah,
the
and so then we would form an opinion, and now information is surfacing. And so...
Yeah.
There's a doctor online, and I know what he's saying is true because HIV is an RNA virus, and the influenza and SARS-CoV-2 is an RNA virus also. So what most people don't understand is the insertion of the amino acids or the insertion of the proteins to make up a sequence of the HIV. They're saying that it's in the vaccine. And so it doesn't matter to me because I'm not going to take any. But the thing is, you have the protein sequences that can be manipulated, and they have seen where they are in abnormal
insurgency. Pull it all together, 52. 30 seconds, pull it all together.
The thing is, I can't put it all together that quick, Dr. D. But what I'm saying is,
give me your main point for tonight.
Mm-hmm. We, this pandemic is not going to be over. You know why? Because they keep saying first, second, and third wave, and we have already read it. All the information is out there to show that they benefit from this. You just explain all these different economical constructs. It's still got to be tested here, tested there. And they're not looking at the side effects of the mask wearing at high altitudes, et cetera. They're not really following the science. Our minds are all being funneled, Dr. D. And this is what it is. And so you can see that the boosters are not working, but yet still they are. But yeah, here's what I'd like for you to do. I'd like for you to just remember this one thing. Get Mr. Peter McCullough to discuss relative and absolute risk reduction so that people can understand how we're being duped. Have a good night.
yes. I'm sure we can talk to him about that, you know, because that'll explain a lot about this whole efficacy and stuff like that people seem to be very confused about. But I think that confusion was used to just kind of get you to have the perception wanted. We were just kind of discussing this article about, you know, in the Science Journal. I want to make this important point before we go about just that, you know, the WHO's formal declaration of public health emergency of international concern legally binds 196 signatories to follow the WHO's recommendations during the emergency. That is, I think, where we have a key point of why we saw kind of this mass effect of how we all went on this bandwagon lockdowns. This stuff that was never done before all of a sudden became, you know, things that were just like easily done. And I think it went a little even beyond that, because I think at one point the WHO was even saying, you know, some of these lockdowns don't make sense, but the spiral of policy had already begun. And not just are all of these countries that signed on legally bound, the article, and this is in science.org, states that drug makers have also signed contracts agreeing to make anti-SARS COVID pills more affordable once that agreement is kept. So until it's reversed. So, you know, there are elements of where the drug companies have kind of signed on where this is a continuing thing, that as long as it's an emergency, certain things are in play. So cheaper drugs, because you're calling it an emergency. So whether it's an emergency or not is, you know, it's cheaper, I guess, in the sense for countries that are afraid to just keep that going. It also speaks lots of other big cooperative efforts that were put in place to make diagnostics, vaccines, all of these things basically fall away once this emergency setting is gone. So there's a lot of things that are at play. And what it doesn't speak to is the actual science of whether there is a pandemic. That is not a part of what some of these conditions are. It's more so that the structuring of the policy and the things that happen because of it are all tied into these emergency settings, all right? And those mechanisms that are needed by some poorer countries. But if we look at a lot of the poorer countries, they're not having the experience with this pandemic the way that some of the richer countries are. So you can see where this cycle or logic of thinking that by keeping these things going, you're actually helping poorer nations actually doesn't even make sense, all right? Because countries that are actually having a lot of difficulty are a lot of what we call our first world nations. And the nations who we would not have expected if it was based on the concepts that they were putting towards us in terms of this pandemic. So regulations governing the PHEIC require signatory nations to report suspect outbreaks to the WHO and to support its responses, although WHO has no way to enforce those rules, the expert committee that recommends whether to continue the PHEIC also lists with each renewal action the nation should take, such as improving variant surveillance, expanding each nation's vaccination coverage. And at the start of this year, for instance, the emergency committee added a new recommendation, monitor and share data on cases and evolutions in animals. So yes, people say, you know, how come we're all responding the same way? There are structures that are in place that kind of provide these guidelines of what should be done. The decision to end a PHEIC has financial implications too. Moderna has pledged not to enforce patents on its messenger RNA vaccine until the pandemic ends. And although a company spokesman declined to say this week how it will identify that moment, Pfizer has not made a similar vaccine pledge, but it and Merck have agreed to allow generic drug makers to make their drugs targeting SARS-CoV-2 until the WHO declares the PHEIC is over. Dozens of companies have now signed up to make Merck's molnupiravir and Pfizer's Paxlovid for a long list of mostly low and lower middle income countries. So there is a lot of money involved in this. There are deals being made based on the fact that we continue these emergency orders. And so you can see that we're getting further and further away from the health aspect and more so into how all these other things interplay. And so countries who want to be involved in all of this, who want to have access, they're going to continue with this. And some of them may not even realize that this is all what is included, but they are a part of this system and they're going along with it. So these are important things to know. That article is really good. You can look for it in Science. I didn't even complete it, but it's called When is a Pandemic Over? World Health Organization Prepares to Confront Thorny Decisions. So go online and you can continue to read it. It's really interesting and it speaks to how these organizations are all involved, bringing countries together, bringing policymakers together, bringing big farm together, and how that interacts with the decisions that our countries make. So I hope that we can make better decisions based on our own climate, our own culture, and the needs of our people. And I think that we will have a better way. So thank you for joining me tonight on The Doctor's In with me, Dr. D. See you next week. We've got Dr. Peter McCullough. We have a week of activities and we'll talk more about that next week. Good night. We'll be right back.